kind of completing the square problem we might have seen on Khan Academy, and that would be one where the, like, at most complicated, the answer comes out to be a fraction. So, let's work this one out together. It's going to come out semi-nicely with, when we take the square root, there actually is a square root. So, what do we do first? We're going to complete the square. What would we do first here? Right, we want to clear out this space for the ideal constant. So we're looking for this number here. The only thing is here that every time you complete the square, we want it to look like this. Like, with an x there and an x there. If I multiply this out, I'm going to get an x squared. But here I have 45x squared. So how do I take this and then the next step have just the 1x squared? 45. So divide this by 45, divide this by 45, divide this by 45. 57 and 45 have a common factor. Good. 19 over 15. 57 by 3. 45 by 3. No common factors here, so this is just 4 over 45. Alright, so now we're ready to complete the square, meaning we're ready to find this number here and this number here. What we know about these two numbers is that they are the same number. They're exactly the same, identical. The reason why we need them to be identical is because we want to write this as a factor squared, so we can take the square root. That's what completing the square is all about. So what would that number have to be? Or how would we find that number so that those two numbers are identical, and then they add up to 19 15ths?
Yeah. Multiply by 1/2.
Multiply that number by 1/2. Same every single completing the square problem. That's exactly what you do. Divide that number right there by 2, multiply by 1/2. And we look at it. So we get 19/30. Make an attempt at making sure everybody's catching what's going on here. Just figured out. Just based on this number here, we figured out that if we want two identical factors, these would have to be them. These would have to be the identical factors, because if I were to multiply this out, I get x squared plus 19 over 30 times x plus 19 over 30 times x again. Right. And plus one more thing, we'll worry about that in just a second. Well, they have a common denominator, we add them up, we get 38/30. Right? 38/30, they have a common denominator, x squared plus, surprise, surprise, 19/15 x. What else do we need to add up to? We chose two factors that are going to multiply it to get x squared. The x terms are going to combine to be 19/15 x. Now, if those are our two factors, which we want them to be, because we want to get these two guys, we also need to include a plus whatever it is when we multiply this by itself, 19/30 by 19/30. What do we get then? We have phones, which have calculators. We have calculators, which also have calculators in them. 361 or something. 30 times 30, 3 times 3 is 900. Okay, well, I'm just going to write this a few more times. It's really, like, if I multiply these two factors out, I will get the x squared plus 19/15 x, that I wanted, but I also would have to add a 361 over 900. Only when I have plus 361 over 900 does it factor this way. Could 361 over 900 be simplified? Probably. Sounds promising. Probably not divisible by 3, maybe by. You have to have this plus 361 over 900 so that you get these two factors. Okay, it's not enough to just have x squared plus 19 15x. If you want these two factors, when you multiply back out, you get 361 over 900. So you need that there. That's new. That was not part of the original equation. What am I getting at here? You're gonna add it to both sides. We gotta get a common denominator. What's the common denominator going to be? I hope so.
Yeah, it will be.
Multiply this by
20.
Oh, it works out. Great. Multiply by 20, we get 900. Multiply this by 20, so we get 80 over 900 plus 361 over 900. Now we have x plus 19/30 squared equals 441 over 900. Okay, it's been kind of a lot of work, but this was the goal here. Really, this was the goal, to get a factor squared, because what can we do when we have a factor squared? If we do both sides now.
Square root.
Square root. Makes it, possible. At least it makes the solving the quadratic possible, where it may not be possible by factoring. Plus 19 over 30. Equals, right, we can take the square root of the numerator over the square of the denominator, if they happen to exist. Is there a square root of 441? 21?
Yeah.
Is there a square root of 900?
30.
30, because we made 900 by doing 30 times 30. So 21 over 30. 21 over 30 could be simplified, can't it?
By 3.
We don't want to? Because we're going to have to do, yeah, all right.
Sure.
That's a good point. So, what we've forgotten one little thing here.
Positive or negative?
Positive or negative. Positive 21 over 30, negative 21 over 30, you got to include the positive and the negative whenever you take the square root of both sides. And then we subtract 19 over 30 from both sides. Possible solutions. One where we take 19/30 and add 21/30, and one where we take 19/30 and subtract 21/30. So it's negative 19/30 plus 21/30. 2/30. 1/15. Negative 19 minus 21/30. Negative 40/30. What x would have to be. If we were to be given that equation and not know about factoring or completing the square, it'd be pretty unlikely that at some point we'd guess that 1/15 is a solution or that negative 4/3 is a solution. Quite a trick. What a lucky guess that would be. So that was, it kind of like brings us up to speed. We may have done a completing the square problem where the solutions came out to be these fraction numbers. But fractions, like whole fractions, I don't think it makes any sense. But one integer over another integer. One nice round number over one nice round number. Okay. So today, that won't happen. We won't to take the square root, and instead of taking the square root of 441 and we get a square root, it just won't be a square root. Like the square root of 21, that doesn't have a square root. The square root of 37, that doesn't have a square root. So, let's get into that. Again, we're going to do complete and square, just like we have done just moments ago. All right. So, I see the first thing that we do being one of two things. This kind of depends on what you decide to do first. Mitch?
Add 9 to each side.
Okay, that's something we can do first. 3r squared minus 8r equals 9. This is the other thing we have to do. This could have been somebody else's first step. These first two steps could be interchangeable. Yeah, divide by 3. We've got to have a 1r squared to use completing the square. So we divide by 3, we get r squared minus 8 thirds r equals 3. That's nice, that's divisible by 3. We're looking for those identical factors. It's going to be r and r. And what will we have is the exact same number here and here. Of what?
3.
If we did it over 3, let's try that. Let's check it out. If that were it, to check, every time you want to check this, you would just multiply these two together and see, do we get this? Right. And if we get this, then we know the constant that we're supposed to have right here. Let's check it out. R times r is r squared. And r times negative 8 thirds is negative 8 thirds r. Well, that's that. I don't think this is going to work out very well because I already have negative 8 thirds r. Right? That's from doing r times r and r times negative 8 thirds. Now I need to do negative 8 thirds times r. That gives me another negative 8 thirds r. And then, I don't really care about the rest of it because what do I get? I get r squared minus 16 thirds r. So no, I wanted to get 8 thirds. I got, it's kind of helpful. Like, this is twice as much as I wanted to get. So if I back myself up, if this is twice as much as I wanted to get, maybe I should start with
4 thirds.
Half of what that is, right? If I start with half, then I'll wind up with half of that. So like I said in the last one, that number that we're looking for to go in both factors, it's always going to be half of that. So if I take negative 8 thirds times 1 half, those can cancel, get negative 4 thirds. Negative 4 thirds. If you put negative 8 sixths, that works too. It could just, negative 8 sixths could be simplified to negative 4 thirds. Now we're looking for the thing that we're going to add to both sides. That'll just be whatever I get when I multiply this all out. The constant that I get, that's what I need to add over here. So r squared minus 4 thirds r minus 4 thirds r again plus what?
16 ninths.
16 ninths, yeah. Those negative 4 thirds times negative 4 thirds, multiply straight across. 16 ninths. I need to add that to both sides. That's a new number that came out of not nowhere. Of course, it was very well planned out, but it came out of some new place. So we need to add it to both sides. I can erase this. This is just our double check. Make sure we factored it correctly. So we need to add 3 and 16 ninths. That's 3 over 1 plus 16 over 9. So that's 27 over 9 plus 16 over 9. There it is. Big payoff for the work that we just did. That's what we are wanting when we're doing a completing the square problem. Okay, so that equals 27 ninths plus 16 ninths is?
44 ninths.
43 ninths? Yeah. 43 ninths. The reason why we want to have that be a factor squared is because what do we do now?
Square root. square root.
Take the square root. The square root. R minus 4/3 equals, we can take the square root of the numerator over the square root of the denominator. So square root of 43, what's that? Square root of 43.
Yeah, there's no, like,
43 doesn't have a square root. 49 does, 36 does, but 43 does not. What's the square root of 9?
3.
So that's nice. The denominator is 3. Don't forget your plus and minus. Whenever you take the square root of both sides, plus or minus. Add 4/3 to both sides. You got 4/3 plus the square root of 43 over 3 and minus the square root of 43 over 3. Put those together, we can have a common denominator, so you're going to be 4 plus or minus 43 over 3. Questions before you try one? Give number one a try. See if everybody does. Alright, as several of you get into something like x squared plus, say, 6x, and you'll even have over here equals, let's say it equals 5 or something like that. Alright. But there is not a full understanding of what happens next, okay? And it's precisely because you're thinking of it as, well, what do I do next? Okay. It's not about what I do.
I think so. Oh, this is
gonna be a big one. Alright, well, now let's do this stuff. So, it's not about what do I do next. It's about what am I looking for. Everything I say from here on out is explaining why we take 6 and divide it by 2. Okay, it's not a magic trick. It's not something you need to memorize. This is what we're looking for. Why do I want a factor squared? What does that enable me to do? Take the square root of both sides. Okay, that's why I put a big starburst around it in the last equation, because that's the reason why we're doing what we're doing. If you really understand the reason why, then no memorization necessary. Okay? So, we're looking for this to be some factor squared. What does square mean? It just means multiply something by itself. Okay? So, this factor are going to be identical. Exactly. First part's easy. I know that has to be an x times an x. Those two parts have to be x. That's why we, in this case, divided everything by 3. And in the one before, divided everything by 45. So we make sure that we have a 1 in front. That part is, let's just say that's assumed. And yes, I divide 6 by 2 and I get 3. The reason why that number has to be 3 is because, here's condition 1, factors are identical. So they have to be exactly the same. Condition number 2. Let's just put it in simple terms. These two numbers, the two numbers, which, by the way, are identical, because the two factors have to be identical, the two numbers that you're putting into those factors have to be identical. So the two numbers add to what? In this case?
6.
They have to add to 6. Okay? Just by those two conditions, they have to be identical and they have to add to 6. I've just given it like one definition of half of a number, half of 6. If they have to be exactly the same, and they have to add up to 6, then those two numbers would have to be 3. We'll just multiply that out for you. X plus 3 times x plus 3 is the only identical factors that will work, because when you multiply it out, we get x squared plus 3x plus 3x, and that gives us the 6x we're looking for. Okay. 4 and 2 won't work. They add to 6, but then we wouldn't be able to do x plus 4 squared or x plus 2 squared. Neither one of those would work. It has to be x plus 3. Now that we know that number has to be 3, when we do the last part of this distribution, we also get plus
9.
That's why we know we need a 9 there. We know that it has to be x plus 3 times x plus 3 because they have to be exactly the same and they have to add to 6. And we know that there will be a 9 there, because once I know that this has to be 3, that constant that I get is a 3. Okay? That 9 is a new, it is not part of the original equation. Right? The original equation didn't have a 9. Now I've added 9, so I need to add 9 to both sides. This factors like that. That was the whole reason I did all that work. That's how it factors, so that I have x plus 3 squared. And 9 plus 5 is 14. This side is still 14. Now we're taking the square root of both sides. And x plus 3 equals plus or minus the square root of 14. X equals subtract 3 from both sides, plus or minus the square root of 14. Okay. I'm going to jump to a step that I saw everybody that I visited with had gotten to. Subtract 1 from both sides and divide by 4. So that leaves x squared minus 2x, that's equal to negative 1/4. If we subtract 1 and divide by 4 on both sides, that's where we will be. Again, starting from the goal, we're wanting some factor that multiplies by itself to give us x squared minus 2x plus something you still yet to find. If it can be squared, it can be written as one factor times its identical copy. We know that has to be an x, that has to be an x. And those two numbers would have to be negative 1 and negative 1. If I had multiplied these out, so far so good, because I get x squared minus x minus x, minus x plus minus x is negative 2x. But then I need to add 1, because negative 1 times negative 1 is 1. And I'll add 1 to both sides. What's 1 minus 1/4? 3/4. Squared equals 3/4. And now?
Square root.
So square root of something squared, it's just that thing. X minus 1
equals
square root of 3, which is not a nice number, so we'll just leave a square root of 3. Over square root of 4,
what's that?
2. Remember your plus or minus. Add 1 to both sides, add 1 plus or minus the square root of 3 over 2. We got a fraction here with a denominator of 2. So if we want to add this, we need a denominator of 2. 2x equals 2 plus or minus root 3 over 2. Next, we'll do an example of a quadratic formula, which you've done. And it's not going to be that big a deal, because it's just a formula. We're just plugging numbers in. But when in the square root part, that square root will not be a nice square root. That's all. Quadratic formula is negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac over 2a. So we have to identify A, B, and C. This quadratic formula is for use with an equation that looks like this.
Oh.
This doesn't look like that, but it's not far away. I'm going to get this to look like that. Add 3x to both sides, and we'll have a 0 on the other side. I'll add 3x to this 7x. 10x minus 5 plus 12x squared equals 0. If I'm paying close attention, I know what a, b, and c are, and I know what I need to plug in with my quadratic formula. What's a?
12x
squared. No, just 12.
Or what?
So a is just this guy here, the number, the coefficient of x squared. 12. B, it's 10, it's the coefficient of x. C, good, negative 5. There's a negative there. Well, that's important. Right, negative B. B is 10. Negative 10 plus or minus square root of B squared, that'd be 100. Minus 4 times A times C. Times A. X equals 10 plus or minus the square root. Let's see, we've got 20 times 12, 240. 100 plus, because it's a negative times negative, plus 240. Simplify that square root of 340. I know it's divisible by 4. 340 is 4 times what? 85. The reason I did that is because the square root of 4 actually is a nice number, 2. Negative 10 plus or minus 2 root 85 over 24. In the numerator, and I'm asking myself now, does the numerator and denominator have a common factor? The numerator has a 2 factor. If I were to distribute that 2, I would get negative 10 plus or minus root 85. And this, of course, is 2 times 12. So, final answer, negative 5 plus or minus the square root of 85. Looks like a big mess, but it's just one step at a time. This quadratic formula, you just need to know what A, B, and C are. B is there, A and C, there's A. It's just a matter of putting everything together, making sure that the stuff inside the square root stays inside the square root, that this divider line here stays, right? Like this entire thing makes up the numerator. So give it a try with number 3. Before we can use the quadratic formula, the equation has to look like what? This is the most important. It's got to have equal 0. Like this one right here, it wasn't written in the right order. The important thing is that the 0 is on the other side. A is the coefficient of x squared, B is the coefficient of x, C is the constant. All right, so how do I get 0 on this side? This doesn't matter. Which one?
Subtract x squared and add 7x.
And add 7x, okay. Here we have like terms, subtract x squared. There are no x terms over here, so just add 7x on here. Add 7x. I'll go ahead and write them in the order of descending powers of x. 3x squared plus 7x plus 3. Now we have it set up. Quadratic formula. X equals, follow the quadratic formula, we get negative b, that's negative 7 plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4 times a times c over 2 times a. 9 minus 36
plus
over 6.
What?
49 minus 36.
85.
Is what?
85.
We're minus subtracting.
Isn't it a negative?
No, subtraction.
It is a negative. We're subtracting. 49 minus 36.
Oh, I thought it was like a negative 36. Like 40 minus 9 is a negative 36.
Oh. Well, no, because there's only, like, we get the 36 comes from 4 times 3 times 3, right? There's only one negative there, so it's negative 4 times 3 times 3.
Negative 4 times 3, which was a negative 12.
Yes.
So negative 12 times 3 would be a negative number. So
yeah.
That's where I, yeah.
Well.
I like doubled the minus. I don't know.
I kind of can see, because there's a minus in the formula, but
yeah.
It's,
so that's
like,
where I messed up. I need to.
If all this together here is, like, if all this is a positive number here, if we're subtracting, subtracting 36, we're subtracting, if this came out to
yeah.
be negative, we'd be subtracting it.
Then
but,
it would apply to that.
Yeah.
But, okay.
So 49 minus 36 is 13 over 6.
That's as simplified as you can get it.
That's it. There's nothing else to do. 13 can't be factored, so it's not like it's square root of 4 times something or square root of 9 times something.
Yeah.
It's trying to be so negative.
It's crazy in here.
Got that flow on that one. Except for my mess up.
There's that one for you to do later on or downtime during class, whatever you have time to do. All right. So now we have to talk about imaginary numbers, and here's the basic idea behind imaginary numbers. Let's say we're using the quadratic formula, and you can see how it would be possible that this number might be bigger than this number, so we might wind up with a negative in the square root, right? That can happen, get a square root of a negative number. Right. Here's a simple equation that happens to. You just take the square root of both sides, and x equals plus or minus the square root of negative 1. Let's talk about the square root of negative 1. What is it?
An imaginary number.
It is an imaginary number. It is I. Okay. Let's establish that it couldn't possibly be any real number. Right. The square root of negative 1 would be a number that multiplies by itself to get negative 1. So maybe it's 1, but immediately that's a silly idea because 1 times 1 is 1. It needs to be negative 1. It's not. So our only hope is negative 1, is that? Well, negative 1 times negative 1 is still positive. And we're out of options. It's not like some fraction is going to work. The only number they can multiply by itself and get the number 1. I'm just kind of ignoring the negative part. The only way to multiply and get a 1. You know, a number by itself to get 1 is to multiply by 1. So we only can do 1 times 1. Positive 1 times 1 doesn't work. Negative 1 times negative 1 doesn't work. So we've run through the full list of logical possibilities, and there are no real numbers. That means numbers that we use in the everyday world that we can count things with and measure gallons of gas and how much money we have and that kind of thing. Real numbers that we could use to count real things.
Do you know why in the world that this is even like a real thing? Like why this can't be?
I don't know like the real story of it, but I have a made up story that I like to tell my kids at night.
What?
The made up story is, this is my made up story for me. One day some person tried to take the square, you know, tried to find the solution to this equation and found that it was the square root of negative 1. And then they thought, is it 1? No. Is it negative 1? No. All right, so that's one of those things in math where, it just doesn't work. It just doesn't work. Okay, so that guy in my story, he just gave up. And he said, you can't take the square root of negative 1. It's not a number. Okay? And maybe that could have been that way for many, many years. Okay, then someone else noticed. They noticed, well, if you take the square root of negative 1, and you multiply it by another square root of negative 1, well, what do you get when you multiply a square root times itself?
Square root of a square.
Square root of a square. The square root of negative 1 squared, so it turns out to be negative 1.
What? The square root of a square?
Is itself?
Yeah, like the square root of 2 times the square root of 2
is
2. Because it's the square root of 2 times 2, it's the square root of 4. Square root of 4 is 2.
Oh my gosh.
So, where a square root of negative 1 doesn't make a whole lot of sense in the real world. If we multiply a square root of negative 1 by a square root of negative 1, now we get a number that is real. That is a number that we have heard of before and can use. Right? So that's, to answer your question with a made-up story, that's why we even bother. With, you know, square root of negative 1, that's not a real number. It doesn't really exist. So, like in my mind here, we have this cloud of numbers that we call the real numbers, okay? And then we have these other numbers that are not real numbers, that are square roots of negative numbers, which they're not real numbers. They're, let's call them complex numbers, okay? And the thing about these complex numbers is if you take a couple of them, right? One of these numbers times another one of these numbers, all of a sudden it shoots out of this cloud of complex imaginary numbers and it creates one of these real numbers. Okay? Kind of a neat little thing. There are other numbers that don't make sense, just like square root of negative 1 doesn't make a whole lot of sense in the real numbers. Right? And that they just never make sense. They don't combine together to make some other useful number, like the imaginary numbers do. Here's an example. Here, let me draw a little
shape. The answer to that one would just be I.
To this one?
Yeah.
Plus or minus I. Mm-hmm. Okay, why do we call it I? We just decided, instead of writing the square root of negative 1 all the time, we'll just call it I, and whenever square root of negative 1 comes up, we'll just call that I. Just like we call pi by pi instead of writing 3.14 every time. Or
it's just I.
I is
a P E.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I like the food pie. Yeah.
So, other numbers that don't make sense, that aren't real numbers, but that don't, like, just never useful. You can't even combine it together and get real numbers back. Like if I divide 1 by 0, that's a similar problem to the square root of negative 1. It just doesn't have any meaning in the real numbers. You can't divide a number by 0. And it's not like if I multiply this by 2 over 0, all of a sudden it makes sense again. It just still doesn't make any sense. But with imaginary numbers, we multiply them together, we get real numbers back out. That's why we deal with them. That's why we bother working with them at all. So
is this imaginary number stuff in your like quest yet?
Yeah.
Okay.
A little bit. Really it's going to be simplifying them, okay? Mostly this, that I squared is negative 1. When you multiply I by itself, you get negative 1. And when we do a continue the square or a quadratic formula problem, if we take the square root of a negative, it involves the solution, the answer involves I.
So is this a review?
No, this is just...
So when are we taking a quiz?
We're going to review some stuff from when we get done with it. We're going to review some stuff from the previous one. We'll have time to review at the beginning of that next class. That we'll talk about.
Is there imaginary stuff on
I'm sure that if you were to search for...
I could search it at numbers on there, and they would have it.
Okay, so let's see why these simplify the way they do. So the square root of negative 4, we'll just break it apart like we always have with square roots as a product of square roots. Negative 1, square root of negative 1, times the square root of 4. The square root of negative 1 is that thing we're calling I. The square root of 4 is 2. And we could write I times 2, but we've gotten used to letter times number, or number times letter.
Right? So, if you take this, you take the square root, and you put there's an I in it. Like the square root.
Like factor out the negative?
Yeah.
Yeah, I just, like, we'll always take a square root of a negative, pull out the square root of negative 1 as I, and then deal with the other square root as we would any other square root.
We'll make it like a positive.
Yeah, like when you pull out the negative 1, now this part will be the square root of
the
positive.
The I is sort of replacing the negative.
The I is the square root of negative 1. It just kind of stands in place of the square root of negative 1. That's the number that it represents. Just like when you write pi, it's standing in the place of 3.14. When you write e, it's standing in the place of 2.618. There's lots of letters out there, numbers out there that are represented by letters. I is one of those. It's representing the square root of negative 1. Okay. Well, if the square root doesn't simplify, you get the square root of negative 1 and the square root of 7. The square root of negative 1 is I, and the square root of 7 is the square root of 7 if you simplify it. Just it is like that. Square root of negative 24. Again, we'll just take out the square root of negative 1. There's 24. Square root of negative 1, we call it I. Square root of 24 can be written as square root of 4 times square root of 6. And square root of 4 is what? 2. So 2 times I times the square root of 6. Now, the reason why we write it in this order is just because we're used to number times letter. And if we say we wrote times square root of 6 times I, that's also true, that's the same, it's not wrong, it's fine. But what's the problem that might come up here?
That it would be negative 1, right? That's the square root of I.
So
it'd be like 6.
To you it looks like this, that I is inside the square root. It's not supposed to be, right? I is just I, it's not the square root of the square root of negative 1. That's like taking the square root of I here. So the problem is, it just looks like I might be inside the square root. It'd have to be like really somehow create some really clear way of saying it. The I is not supposed to be in the square root, it's just I, it's the square root of negative 1, it's over there, that's all. That's why we write I on the left side of the square root sign, so that there's not that confusion. Alright, let's combine some, we'll come back to that in just a second. Let's combine some complex numbers. So we got this complex number minus this complex number. And the final result is probably exactly what you're thinking.
Is that a
carry
number?
It is a,
square root
complex number. It's just going to be some real number plus or maybe minus some other real number times that. So we got parentheses here for no real reason. Like there's nothing to distribute, there's nothing divided, there's nothing to raise to a power, nothing right on there. So we just have negative 1 plus I. But this parentheses, what's happening to this parentheses?
Distributing
a negative 1, so you have minus 7 plus 5i. Combining like terms, negative 1 minus 7 is negative 8. I plus 5i, 6i. But that part is it of that part, yes.
Oh.
So that, like, combining complex numbers in that way just looks like collecting like terms. Let's see what happens if we multiply two complex numbers together. You go ahead and give it a try. It's just like multiplying two binomials. Right? You can, for the time being, you can treat I like x. If I multiply two i's together, that's I squared. If I have two I terms, I can combine them together.
Can you foil that?
Right.
So the one that we just did, that's it. Like, that's all you do? That's the answer.
If the question is, please combine these like terms, or combine these complex numbers, then yes, all done.
Oh, man.
Is that on the quiz?
Together, like you would any two binomials. Negative 1 times negative 1 is 1. Negative 1 times 5i is negative 5i. Negative 5i times negative 1. Positive 5i. Negative 5i times positive 5i. Negative 25i squared. All right, here's 1. And what's negative 5i plus 5i?
Zero.
Okay, so that just cancels out. Now, do you remember what I squared is equal to?
Negative.
It's equal to negative 1. So this is negative 25 times negative 1. So what is this?
It's
a positive 25. What? I should have gotten 26. 25 plus 1. So we multiply those two complex imaginary numbers together and got a real number. So I squared is like we talked about, is negative 1 because when we multiply negative square root of negative 1 times square root of negative 1, square roots cancel each other out and we get negative 1.
And what if it's cubed?
What if it's cubed? Let's look at I cubed. What does something cubed mean? Girls, if you could please stop talking. What does something cubed mean? By itself three times. Okay, so then I times I times I. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna collect these together in a convenient way. I'm going to collect two of these together and call it I squared, right? I times I. That's a negative 1. And then that's just that I left over. Negative 1 times I. Negative I. That's why that's negative I. These next two.
Then it's positive and it's negative again.
These next two I got wrong. I typed them out wrong. I was typing too fast. That should be 1 and this should be I. So if you could fix those.
Wait, it should be 1 and then I?
That should be 1 and that should be I. Yeah. And we'll all be fairly convinced of that. I to the 4th, that's I times I times I times I. Well, these together are I squared. These are I squared. I squared times I squared.
It's a negative 1 times a negative 1.
Which makes it positive 1. And now, when we multiply imaginaries together, like there's this kind of cycle that we go through. Because if I do I to the 5th, let me just go ahead and write that quick as I to the 4th times I.
1 times I.
This is 1, and what's 1 times something?
1.
The thing, whatever the thing is you're multiplying. 1 times I. 1 times I is I. So I to the 5th is equal to I. I to the 5th is the square root of negative 1. So when you multiply a bunch of square roots of negative 1s together in a long string, some of them will work out to negative 1, two more will work out to another negative 1, and those will multiply together to make a positive 1. Okay. So every 4 i's that you multiply together, they're just a 1.
Yeah.
And if you have another 4 i's multiply together, that's a 1, another 4, that's a 1. So that if we were to say I to the 30, just 30. What? Okay.
Could
you do it?
About
1? Hmm?
I to the
6
times I to the
5th. Well, let's think about that. I to the 6th means I times I times I times I times I times I.
Right?
6 I's and 5 more I's. How many eyes is that?
Not 11.
We could do it. Yeah, we could do it in lots of different ways that add up to 30. I to the 15th, I've added the 15th. But I want to make use of that I to the 4th. What's I to the 4th times I to the 4th?
16. But that would be... No, because a negative to the 4th is a 1.
Yes. So that would be 1. I mean, we don't have enough yet because we're not up to 30 yet.
No.
I to the 4th again. I to the 4th.
16.
I to the 4th again.
1. 24. 32.
Oh, too many.
So I to the 2nd.
So we need just an I squared now. So what's this? And
one.
Times I squared.
I
so
squared.
It is
one.
-1.
It's -1.
Yeah.
It's always.
So it'll always be either
a -1 or an I.
Yeah, -1 or an I, or negative I.
I is it could be a 1.
It could be a 1.
If it's to the 4.
If it's to something, a power that's divisible by 4.
So
you're going
to
run
I to the 32nd,
then it would be 1. So we could do that faster by making it I to the, we did a bunch of I to the 4th until we got a total of I to the 28, right?
Yeah.
That's 7 I to the 4th multiplied together.
Yep.
Times I squared.
Well,
so that's negative.
I think it's the
gladiator.
Yeah. What? Oh yeah, history's watching gladiator.
What?
Because they're not
all right,
like,
all the way down here.
Oh, yeah.
All right, let's solve this equation. Let's keep going. If you want more review time and such, let's pay attention. Square root of both sides. Plus or minus the square root of negative 624. Well, again, like I said, square root of negative 1 times square root of 624. What's the square root of negative 1 called? I to the square root of. Let's do square root of 4 times 624. It's divisible by 4. Or maybe it's even to the trust. Let's try 16. But the negative is right here. So 16 times 39?
Yeah.
Awesome. Okay. Square root of 16?
4.
4, so plus or minus 4 times I times the square root of 39.
Bang.
And I would try to simplify the square root of 39, but it's not going to work.
Nope.
Maybe divisible by 9, but it's not divisible by 9. It's not divisible by 4, any even number.
The I
came from right here.
Oh,
because
okay.
It's a negative 624, so we take the negative part out. The square root of positive now, and then we deal with that like normal, and we just call it square root of negative 1 I.
Okay.
All right, let's work on this one. We'll add 9p squared to both sides. We get 12p squared, we'll subtract 7, get negative 3, divide by 12. Simplify down to negative 1/4. Take the square root of both sides. Like always, we'll just take it as plus or minus the square root of negative 1 times the square root of positive 1/4. Square root of negative 1, that's the I. Does 1/4 have a square root? So, if we were like traditional mathematicians, we'd write 1/2, plus or minus 1/2. So, while imaginary numbers are completely different numbers and a completely different cloud of numbers, dealing with them is not that big a deal, especially when we're just solving an equation. You just need to make sure that you pull the square root of negative one aside, call it I, and then just all the other square root stuff works like any other square root. That's exactly what it is, just the square root of some number. Gonna be super simple because we're just using the quadratic formula again. But when we take the square root, what do you think is gonna be inside the square root?
Negative number.
Well, there will be I in the square root. Yeah, there will be I involved. There will be I involved. So again, the quadratic formula, negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared is 4ac over 2a. Okay. Alright, so a is b. X equals negative plus or minus the square root of 4 squared minus 4 times A times the C over 2 times A. Check that if you want to make sure that I got it right. Okay, no bad idea. Negative 4 plus or minus the square root of what is 16 minus 264? Negative.
Negative 248.
248? Used to imaginary numbers and working with those solutions, I can just jump to negative 4 plus or minus I, that's the square root of negative 1 piece of it, times the square root, I'm hoping to simplify the square root of 248. I know that's 4 times something. 4 is 2, that's 2i root 62, 12. So what we're going to do is use a quadratic formula like you already have done and realize that solving these equations where you really just need to get the square. Notice there's no x, there's no t, there's not going to be any, we could take the square root of just the parentheses there, just like we do with completing the square after we divide by negative 5. In all of these cases, it's going to involve taking the square root of both sides, one of the other side, over there's going to be. Multiply these together, we're going to have I squareds somewhere. I'll guarantee that. And that I squared is going to be, what is I squared?
Negative 1.
So any term that has an I squared, you turn the I squared into a negative 1 and simplify that.
Mr. Stewart,
yep.
Could we go over 13 together?
Sure. In order for this to be ready for the quadratic formula, it has to be ax squared plus bx plus c equals 0.
Yeah.
So let's do that. You subtract x squared from both sides? Okay. That's the way to go. So we have 0 equals negative s squared minus 3s minus 14, which, you know, obviously is the same as if I said all that stuff equals 0. Whatever the equals 0 side, it doesn't matter. There we go. ABC. What's A?
Negative 5.
negative 14. So x equals negative b, and b is a negative number. So negative negative 3. Negative 3 squared is 4 times a times c. 2 times a. 3 times the square root of 9. Negative times negative times negative will be minus 4 times 14, 56. 9 minus 56, 2. Nine minus 56 is negative
47.
Plus or minus I root 47.
What if you had just added the 14 and the 3x?
That's a good question. Then your answer is obviously going to be the same because the solutions is other solutions. If you do all your math correctly, it's going to be the same. Your answer is going to look more like this. The negative wound up being with the 3 rather than the 2. But that's the same thing. Because if I back up to where I had a negative 2 there, remember real quick that negative 3 fourths, that's really a negative 3 divided by a positive 4, or a positive 3 divided by a negative 4. Either way, we wind up with this negative fraction. So this negative here in the denominator, it's just the fraction, it's a negative fraction. Whether we apply it to the denominator or distribute it to the numerator, it doesn't matter. You should get an I, because you'll get, if you just add 14 and 3s to both sides, you'll get s squared plus 3s plus 14.
Yeah.
So your a will be positive 1 and your c will be positive 14. So you have negative 4 times 1 times 14, which is still minus 56.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I did that wrong.
Okay. Going back to our first days of factoring and solving by factoring. The good old days when there was a 1 out in front of the m squared, not a 2 or a 7 or something. And the numbers were such that we didn't have to use a quadratic formula or repeating the square because it was possible to factor. Going to make it clear, like, you have to factor it. You cannot just apply the quadratic formula to everything. I mean, it's possible, but it would require you to exercise these skills.
Yeah, so you can use the quadratic formula?
On anything. On any quadratic equation, yeah. That's why it's called capital T, the quadratic formula. But for this one, we can factor it. Like I said, it's from the good old days. We just threw an m in front of those, you know, on the front side of those two factors. And what two numbers do we need to fill in these factors so that we multiply them together, we get negative 65, and we add them together, we get positive 5, 13. Negative 5,
yeah,
13. Sounds like we have agreement.
M equals 5 and M equals negative 13.
True, but I will never, ever not do this step I'm about to do.
M minus 5 equals 0. 4 and plus 13 equals 0 minus 13.
Uh-huh. Right. So we can set each of these equal to 0. Why? Here, let me ask it a different way. Let's say that instead n minus 5 times n plus 13 equaled 24. Does n minus 5 equal 24?
No.
No.
Could it?
Could.
Well, here it places something.
So this could be 24. Let's try. It could be 24. The question is, does it have to be 24?
No.
No.
It could be anything.
Could be, yeah. It literally could be anything. It could be any number.
Yeah.
It could be 7.369. There is a number. There is a number. When you multiply it by 7.369, we'll give you 24. It can even be negative 7.369. And this could be some negative number that will give you 24. Any number.
Yep.
It could be 24 though, right? But the problem is I can't guarantee that it's gonna be 24. I'm trying to find it. So what I must be saying over here is that I guarantee you that n minus 5 is 0. Why can I guarantee it?
Because something else
equals 0.
There's no other way but for one of these to be 0 to multiply and get 0. Like, if this were 12, well, we know we multiplied and got 0, so this must be 0. If this were 10, then what would this have to be? It has to be 0. There's no way around one of those being 0.
Okay.
Guaranteed. So there we go. Set those equal to 0, we solve, and we get two solutions. Just a quick reminder. Here, we have solved the equation. In contrast, I could be given m squared plus 8m minus 65. These are two different problems. What's the difference between the way these two different problems start?
That one's equal to 0, and you're not going to make that one equal to 0.
No.
Yeah.
You don't make things equal to 0.
It
doesn't have to be equal to anything.
That's not an equation.
It's not an equation.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But you can
I can't solve it.
No,
because it's not an equation.
Yeah, you can
but you can factor it.
Yeah.
And that's the difference. Like, I would tell you in this case to solve for n.
Yeah.
In this
and
case to
factor
the quadratic.
So if it's equal to 0, you can solve it.
Right. Or anything. Like, I can't solve this because it's just not impossible. Because in the end, I would tell you that m is something. I can't know what m is going to be until I know, like,
because that could be anything.
I plug in m, and what am I supposed to get when I plug something in for m? Could be 0, could be 1, could be 12. I don't know. Nobody said.
I didn't know.
I don't know.
Yeah, it could be I.
Could be I.
So,
I
negative.
I will ask you a question like this, and it just tests your understanding of the solutions to a quadratic equation.
That would be minus 7x plus 5.
That
equals 0.
Okay, equals 0.
Sorry, I didn't see that.
So, like she's just thinking backwards, right?
Yeah.
I must have gotten this from solving this.
I mean.
Likewise.
And then it'd be x squared.
Well, let's
yeah,
give us an in between here.
Yeah.
I must have done this because
of that.
That.
Yeah.
X squared.
So x squared.
Minus 7x
yeah.
plus 5x minus 3.
Yeah. Bang.
Alright. What about if there was a times 5 out there?
You'd have to distribute.
You would have to distribute. Would this have those solutions?
Thank you.
It would.
Just about.
These would still have to be zero, and so this still my solution to be 7 and negative 5. This would be 5x squared minus 35x plus 25x minus 175. By 5, so it'd be 5 minus 10x minus
that's
still 175. But this still has those two solutions. Because if I were to go through the work, I would factor it. The 5 would get factored out. I would still solve these two equations to get 7 and 95. That's why the instructions will say write a quadratic equation. How many quadratic equations exist with those solutions?
Mm-hmm.
Any.
Yeah.
Well, an infinite amount. I can put any number out here, and I have another unique quadratic equation that still has those solutions. All right. So what would naturally come after factoring, solving using factoring? Anybody remember what happened next?
After
factoring.
I got that.
No.
Like
maybe.
Harder factor. Okay. Let's get a nice simple example here.
11:22.
All right. Gonna factor by grouping. First, you have to follow what I like to call the first rule of factoring quadratics. Anybody remember what I keep referring to when I say that? All the terms, look for
like
terms,
like
common factors.
Common factors.
Sorry.
Common factors. Do these share a factor?
Yeah.
Four.
Or two.
Four, just two.
Two. G.
Times what goes in here?
Z.
Nine.
Oh, wait, just kidding. Now Z.
Nine Z squared plus. What is that?
Oh, wait.
18.
13?
18.
18. 18.
Oh,
plus nine. Plus nine.
Eight.
Eight.
Got that last eight.
If you don't factor that out, that's going to make factory grouping really difficult.
Yeah.
All right, so we factor by grouping.
Yeah.
Walk me through it.
Then you
multiply the 9 and the 8.
That's right.
Yeah.
And you don't remember that, I forgot.
I did this last night.
Something that equals 72 when you multiply them together. All right, because we are going to split this 18z into something z plus something z, and of course when I add those together I need to get 18. What?
No, I have one question.
Oh. What two numbers multiply to 72 and add to 18?
72.
6 and 12. We'll pick it up. We'll have some.